Northpointe friends and family, welcome to our online service. I really hope that you had a blessed week, and if you didn't, please come together so that we can center and focus our thoughts on the sermon later on. And this first song that Beth Zillia said, come, let us worship. So please, join us, either stand and worship with us, or sit in your chair with your coffee and your jammies, all nice and comfy, and just sing and glorify God with us this morning.
Story began terribly with the overthrow of the promised land. Jerusalem is leveled. also a chilling apparition, a hand writing on a wall, and prophecies that would later come true, sometimes centuries later. After this thrilling ride, we slow down to chapter 9. Please turn to this chapter of Daniel and print your electronic Bibles. The setting is still Babylon, about 2,500 years ago. Darius is the latest king after his Daniel had prophesied. The era King Belshazzar was overthrown. It is the seventh decade of Daniel's exile. He's an old man, pushing 80. At a time when 80 was now the new 60. Probably still isn't. No special effects we needed to film the start of chapter 9. It begins with Daniel meditating on some writings, and then lifting up a prayer, a confession, and petition. Let's read the first three verses. In the first year of Darius, son of Xerxes, a Mede by descent, who was made ruler over the Babylonian kingdom, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood from the scriptures according to the word of the Lord given to Jeremiah the prophet, that the desolation of Jerusalem would last 70 years. So I turned to the Lord God and pleaded with him in prayer and petition, in fasting and in sackcloth and ashes. Before we reflect on these rich and challenging verses, let's follow Daniel's good example of minus the sackcloth and ashes. Let us pray. Sovereign, this morning, help us to appreciate and learn from the writings and example of this exile, this wise and good man who served you so faithfully and who loved you and his neighbors so fully and so courageously. May we join you together in trusting you, listening to you, waiting on you, and relying on your sovereignty and your loving kindness. And may this message and meditation to all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning, I'd like us to reflect on what we can learn from how Daniel prayed and what he prayed. If prayer is one of the practices of discipleship you struggle with, if you're like me and prayer remains a still underappreciated and underutilized means of grace, a gift from God still unwrapped, I hope that together we can find Daniel's words and his example helpful. As Pastor Tom noted last Sunday, prayer was a vital part of Daniel's daily routine. He didn't wait for the right mood or setting or even for saving dishes. Daniel prayed regularly and often. Recall from chapter 6 that even his enemies knew how established and essential prayer was for Daniel. That's why those backstabbing government officials knew they could trap him into breaking the law by convincing Darius to declare a 30-day ban on all prayers except to the king. The conspirators knew that Daniel, in every other matter, was a loyal subject to the king. Wouldn't even take 1 month off from prayer, but would continue to pray to God as written in chapter 6, verse 10, just as he had done before, 3 times a day, getting down on his knees in prayer, giving thanks to his God. This is personally convicting. Because a brief moratorium on prayer wouldn't bother me the way it did Daniel. I could manage to decline God's gracious invitation to prayer. My excuses would be so much weaker than risk of being thrown in a den of lions. Feeling convicted may be a good place to start, but to grow in discipleship, it is also helpful to focus on the good examples of Daniel, of Christ, who prayed constantly, and the good examples of many of my friends here at North Point Church, who also pray regularly and pray generously for the sake of others. Even when I find out that some of you have recently been praying for my family more than I do, I don't feel embarrassed by that. before, three times a day. For good or for bad, habits are powerful things. We are creatures of habit. But we are also creatures who can choose to establish healthy habits, to give them small footholds in our daily routines and encourage them to grow over time. When a routine of regular prayer is established, then, even during those difficult days, when we feel tired or distracted, habit will be our ally. Now, I agree with those who resist allowing faith to become nothing but a lot of routines and habits. I agree with the nothing but part of that statement, and not letting these means, these routines, distract us from the proper ends, worshiping God, loving our neighbors. But in humility and trust, allowing our faith to shape our routines and habits can be part of a rich journey of discipleship. Eugene Peterson's book, Along Obedience in the Same Direction, comes to mind. God spent years instilling healthy routines into that ragtag tribe he brought up out of Egypt. From Exodus to Deuteronomy, the Bible describes many new holy practices the Lord established in their daily, weekly, and annual routines. And he did this so that they might flourish. It's worth the effort, a sustained effort, establishing and maintaining regular routines of prayer and Bible study. Speaking of Bible study, while chapter 9 is mostly about prayer, notice what Daniel is doing in verse 2, what initiated and informed his prayer. He was reading and meditating on Scripture. In this instance, the writings of the prophet Jeremiah foretelling the present exile. When you sit or kneel to pray, or sit, just stay there, and don't know what to say, try starting with Scripture. Perhaps recite the Lord's Prayer, or God-inspired words written by the prophets or by Christ's disciples. Or just pray one of the Psalms. The preference for a completely extemporaneous individual prayer seems a more modern thing. Don't be bothered by saying things that have already been said. That's part of the idea. When we pray the Psalms back to God, we join in communion with a great host of brothers and sisters in faith, near, far, past, and present. It's a great company to pray with. But maybe instead, you're like I can be, with lots to say, talking much more than listening during prayer. As nonsensical as it seems, inviting to prayer with our Lord to converse with Him, the most creative, awesome, wise, experienced, and remarkable one who ever was and ever will be, I can show up talking and not listening, and keep on talking until I conclude with an amen, get on with the rest of my day. It is business. We're not even going to sit quietly and patiently. Whatever, it's not good. But I found Daniel's approach to prayer, starting with Scripture, helpful. It's an approach offered in one of Pastor John's recommended books, Face to Face by Kenneth Boer. This book is primarily composed of Bible verses, but it's not a typical Bible study with expert commentators guiding us through our reading. As the title Face to Face implies, the purpose of this book is to lead us without any scholarly commentary straight to the source of these verses, into a conversation with God through the Bible and its message for our lives. It assists us in the discipleship of prayer by weaving it in with the daily practice of reading and reflecting on Scripture. We take in God's inspired words and can respond with our questions, praises, confessions, cries for help, petitions, thanks, intercessions. Or we can pray the verses on these pages and just silently reflect on them. I found it very helpful every morning to be guided respond, how great thou art. Or, mighty in awe, just silent, take it in. Whether walking in the woods or reading scripture, silent in awe is sometimes the most appropriate prayerful response. Daniel understood that whatever our response, it is God who initiates and leads in meaningful prayer. And after Daniel read God's message through the prophet Jeremiah, following God's lead, he responded in prayer. Let's read verses 4 through 6. I pray to the Lord my God and confess, Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned and done wrong. We have been wicked and have rebelled. We have turned away from your commands and laws. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princesses, and our ancestors, to all the people of the land. Note that Daniel prays, not as an individual, but as part of the children of Israel. And he prays not just for himself, but for the children of Israel. It's not an I and me prayer, but an us and we prayer, including all the people, past and present, near and far, the rulers and the regular folks of this nation. This seems remarkable for a couple of reasons. First, in our modern individualistic culture, many of us define ourselves based on our personal abilities and achievements by the degrees and titles we've earned as individuals. We find affirmation and seek fulfillment, even salvation, individually. This wasn't how Daniel saw himself. This man, renamed Belteshazzar by Nebuchadnezzar, had achieved great things during his years in exile, and his fame and influence were surpassed only by kings. But recall, he did not identify as this rock star of the most powerful nation of the age. Instead, he entered into prayer as Daniel, his Hebrew name, tying him to a defeated nation. They would come to this national identity throughout 65 years of exile. It was also remarkable because he did this despite the deliberate efforts of the Babylonian captors to destroy that identity. The promised land was overrun, the temple level, the exiles were forced to learn new customs and a new language. And some were given Babylonian names. But Daniel saw Babylon as the world he was in, not the world he was of. He identified himself as a child of Abraham, a part of the people of the covenant. This perspective should inform our approach to prayer. Because through Jesus, we have been grafted into that family tree. As we read in Ephesians chapter 2, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. We are in this world, but we are not of it. Each of us have been given a place in this world by God to be parts of the body of Christ for the sake of this world. That's our identity, our affirmation, our fulfillment, and our salvation. As Paul explained in his second letter to the Corinthians chapter 12, for we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one is a part of it. We don't pursue our salvation individually. We follow Jesus in the company of friends, for the sake of others, to the glory of God. That's how we should pray. That's how we should live. As making God's gift of prayer even more generous. When Jesus says, Our Father, he is including us with him in the word Our, and in his prayer. Again, it's great company to pray with. In verse 13, Daniel continues with this confession. Just as it is written in the law of Moses, all this disaster has come on us, yet we have not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our sins and giving attention to the truth. There's no deflection here, no blaming those blessed, faithful Israelites to the north, or even those pagan Babylonians. The name Daniel in Hebrew means God is my judge. True to his name, Daniel accepts God's judgment and his punishment. To complain that the destruction of the temple and the exile of Babylon were unjustly would have been a prideful presumption that he was God's judge. Daniel knew that we must accept God's judgments, trust in him, and rely on his sovereignty and his loving grace. Daniel's prayer concludes in verses 17 through 19 with a petition. Now, our God, hear the prayers and petitions of your servant. For your sake, Lord, look with favor on your desolate sanctuary. Give ear, our God, and hear. Open your eyes and see the desolation of the city that bears your name. We do not make requests of you because we are righteous, but because of your great mercy. Lord, listen. Lord, forgive. Lord, hear and act. For your sake, my God, do not delay, because your city and your people bear your name. Daniel's prayer is then interrupted by the sudden appearance of Gabriel. Now, this morning, I do not have time or the ability to discuss the final eight verses of this chapter in detail. I'll just say that Gabriel brought God's answer. And like the answers to so many of our prayers, it wasn't exactly what Daniel requested. All the exiles were not swiftly transported back to a rebuilt Jerusalem and the temple. God's answer was to provide Daniel a new vision, with images and timelines that called for interpretation, but none was provided. But what seems clear from this vision and the rest of Daniel's account is that our righteous Lord is sovereign over our present and our future. His ways may be higher than our ways, and his thoughts higher than our thoughts. But God is in charge, and God is good. I'd like to close by returning to the prayer that began this chapter. It was the prayer of an old man who'd been through a lot on behalf of a nation in exile, seemingly unsupported. But it was a prayer based on the foundation of hope. The prophecy of Jeremiah that Daniel was reading includes these encouraging words. This is in chapter 29, verses 10 and 11. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my own promise to bring you back to this place, Jerusalem. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Daniel's hope helps us understand how he not only endured, but prevailed in the Babylonian exile. In hope, he made prayer and study of Scripture essential, regular, and integrated parts of his life. In hope, he lived and prayed as part of the covenant community of the children of God. And he grounded his hope on God's faithfulness and sovereignty, not on his or his people's righteousness, but on the Lord's great mercy. We can also rely on his hope. Even more comforting, even more confident, on this side of Christ's resurrection. We not only have access to prayer and the same scriptures available to Daniel, we have also been blessed by God's perfect revelation through his Son Jesus, who declared in Matthew 13, 17, For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, but did not see by knowing Jesus, the fulfillment of that hope. Let us pray. Lord, you have always been and still are ever present in the heavens and the depths, on the far side of the sea, in the darkness and in the light. You are there. So why do we keep missing you? Please, Lord, give us hearts and ears and eyes that can tune to receive your revelation through your scriptures, your creation, and the many mercies that sustain and enrich our lives. Help us together to know and live in your holy presence. We need you and always will. Amen.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, word of God speak. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, I hear your voice, the word of God speak. Washing my eyes to see your majesty, be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.